warming. Here's the caves above the groundwater table. They're starting to fill back in. But as they get, was that your mom?
I don't know.
It was Fondell. As the cave gets near the surface, it starts falling in. And he's, it's a long telephone call. This is like women in their purses. That's why they never answer the phones. They're just looking for their goddamn phone. My wife never answers. She's in your purse. Honey, dump it out. I'm trying to reach you. So the caves fall in, and that creates what's called karst topography. Each individual one is a sinkhole. All right? And sinkholes are known to eat entire neighborhoods, consuming children on tricycles. The entire cave falls in. So this is true. So here's the groundwater table, caves forming down here, caves filling in here, and then they get near the surface, they fall in, sinkholes. Topography is called karst topography. Each individual one, a sinkhole. Oh, look at that. So where's the groundwater table here? You're looking at it, right where the surface of water. So here are three sinkholes in New Mexico. Look at them all, all right? Look at them all, karst topography. Falling in. So when you look at that, this is due to groundwater dissolving out caverns, and then the caverns collapse. Look at Tallahassee, Florida. This is a satellite view. Look at all the sinkholes filled with water where it is sunk in. The groundwater table underneath is exposed. Wow, look at that. Here's one in a neighborhood in Florida. All right, nobody knew. They bought that house. They didn't know there was a cave underneath them. And now and it's happening all throughout such regions. Florida has got it worse, where neighborhoods are finding, particularly those near Tallahassee, that they do have sinkholes underneath them, and they are starting up. They're having to do all kinds of construction. The houses are starting to slip in, and they're having to pump in all kinds of concrete.
I have learned yet another house in a West Orange County community may have a sinkhole forming underneath it. We first reported in May about two homes
Orlando,
in
the Florida
subdivision that had to be stabilized by engineers. Now a hole has formed underneath a third home. Channel 9's Steve Barrett is there live, and Steve, it apparently is going to take weeks of cement work to fix this problem.
Yeah, Marty, the underside of this latest home is devouring up to 8 truckloads of cement a day through little pipes like that, and it could go on for an entire month. That's quite a void under the home.
No insurance covers this.
To use the word sinkhole. And although this house doesn't look that bad on the outside, it is getting much worse on the inside. Rodolfo Solaris is ready to sell his home back to Lennar Homes. He didn't want to talk on camera because of pending litigation, but he noticed his walls beginning to crack away several months ago because of a giant void under his home. In this neighborhood, several owners are getting a sinking feeling about their brand new homes.
It's concerning because I want to make sure that everything's safe and I make sure that everything is covered. You know, I want to make sure that Lennar now comes through for the homeowners here.
The home directly behind it still sits vacant, bearing the scars from a similar sinking incident. Back in May, geotechnical engineers pumped thousands of yards of cement under this and a third home in the Stony Brook Hills development. But in this development, as new homes still go up, the three problematic homes are a sore spot for Lennar.
So anywhere, you've got limestone country. We could be outside Austin, Texas, limestone country. You're going to have these kinds of issues, all right? But what you can do with sinkholes. Oh! Look at that! Oh, nothing like a long rope. Can we do that again? Let's see. Yeah! Do that flip! Oh, it's a backbreaker! Spring break! Here we go! And then once the sinkholes continue to sink, the whole ground is falling down. Here is actually a limestone mine, a quarry. It's all limestone, but it's fallen down so much you're getting just the walls left between. These are called towers, or tower karst. So much sinkage that just the walls between the caverns are left. Here we are in the Lee River area of China. Oh, with rice paddies. Here's the Lee River. Rice paddies out there. What created that topography? Groundwater. Dissolving caverns and the caverns collapsing to where most of the land has collapsed away with just the towers in between. Tower karst. All right, what happened here? Groundwater made that country. Hot springs. Sometimes the water gets so deep where it gets hot, finds its way back up to the surface, so it's warm. Here are some fishermen on one side where the water is cold, fishermen, and others swimming where the hot spring is. I think he's got underwear on, but maybe not. Hot springs are magical. How many of you have been to hot springs? What did you smell?
Sulfur.
Sulfur. So rotten eggs, because hot water dissolves lots of minerals. Should you swallow hot spring water? God, no, don't do that. Have you? Would you? They also have hot mud baths. Have you wandered out into a hot mud bath? Any of you had your body smeared with hot mud? How was it? Pretty good. It felt good. Yeah, it did. It's okay for you. It moisturizes, but you don't lick it, all right? So hot springs where water goes down really deep. It does get hot when you go down. The average geothermal gradient, how hot it gets per kilometer, is 20 degrees centigrade. That's average. But some places, it's colder. In other places, it's even a hotter gradient. We're really hot. It'd be around 100. Yellowstone, really hot. All right? And you get a lot of hot water. Ooh, look at that. I mean, this bit of map says that 20 degrees C at 10,000 feet, the water's going to be 62 degrees C or 141 Fahrenheit. Would you go into a hot tub or hot spring that had 141 degrees? It's not boiling. What would happen to you at 141? You're going to die. You're going to die. And at times, hot springs, no regulation. They don't have to come in. What is your perfect hot tub temperature? 107? You're hot. Who else?
103.
Okay. And? 94? And so there's a narrow window that feels good to us, right? Yeah. And hot springs don't know that, so people do get caught. Usually you move into a hot spring carefully. And it's mixing with colder water that was already there, and so you get into the mixture zone, but sometimes it comes out fast and can engulf you. So be careful when you go into hot springs. I'm trying to save you. That hot water is full of dissolved minerals. It precipitates those minerals. This is called travertine. Oh, look at that. Oh, the travertine is usually calcite minerals. Sometimes it's other minerals that are there. Whatever was in that hot water, some sulfide minerals as well. You smelled the sulfur. Calcium carbonate, iron sulfide. Look at all the travertine deposits created by precipitation from hot springs. So there we are, travertine. Havasu Canyon, Arizona. Hot water's precipitating out. Here we are in Turkey. And while you're looking for the person that has no clothes at all in this view, you're looking at travertine deposits from hot springs. Did you find them?
Nope.
And then geysers are another special part of groundwater. This is where water gets so hot it goes to steam and blows out. What you need, usually the volcanic region, water flows in where it's over 100 degrees C or 212, and it blows the steam, and then the water's gone. And the geyser dies for a while. And then new water comes, so it repeats itself. Old Faithful, it repeats itself. Water comes in, blows the steam, it's gone. New water comes in, it repeats the process, okay? Look at that. Oh, beautiful, geyser at rest. So the water comes in, blows the steam, and it's gone. All right, requires temperatures over 100 degrees C. Watch this. We're on Iceland. Okay, stand there with me. The ground is shaking. You can hear it rumble. What's going to happen here? Water is moving in to the hot area. Whoa! You got to do this. And then it dies away. Is it completely done? What do you think? You hear the children giggling? Oh yeah, a little bit more. I have stood near Old Faithful and other geysers, and I think I know a lot about geysers. I know how they're formed. I can explain them. But I yip it along like a child when it erupts out. Oh, my God. It's just nature is wonderful. Now a bit on the side of excessive welling. We could damage that. When we sink in really deep wells, we get this cone of depression. Shallow wells go dry. Trees begin to die. Lakes disappear. We irrigate and turn our deserts even into green baskets. There we go. But you know what happens to the soil after a while with the creation of salts. And the only way to prevent the salt buildup is to irrigate a lot and wash the salts further down. okay? So it takes a lot of water to do this. And with that, we've seen groundwater tables dropping all over the world. It's a big issue, okay? From Beijing, where it's dropping 6 feet a year, Mexico City, 11 feet per year. Chicago, its groundwater table's greatly depleted, all right? San Antonio, they published the groundwater table surface in the San Antonio newspaper daily. So it goes down, and in the end, you get dried beds that used to have water. Owens Lake in Owens Valley is a source of water for L.A. Los Angeles wanting to build itself. Money was to be made. Developers were ready. And so the public officials of L.A. quietly bought up all the water rights up Owens Valley, which is right here, okay? Down at this part of California, L.A. would be down here. They bought up all that land, all the mineral rights from that, and sucked the water to L.A. so that we could have homes there, all right? And the trees died, and the lakes died. Owens Lake was just a lake bed now, just a plume of dust. It took court battle after court battle after court battle, and just 2 years ago, L.A. was ordered by courts, and they fought like hell to put some water back, but only some. Wow. All right? Here's another one. Ogallala Aquifer, not a lake. It's an aquifer. In all stretching from South Dakota through Nebraska, all the way down Oklahoma into Texas and New Mexico, it's a huge aquifer. Now, this was known as the Great American Desert. And back when the covered wagons were coming out of the east, leaving New York and Pennsylvania and Massachusetts and heading across Illinois into Colorado, Nebraska, it got drier and drier and drier. And they're trying to reach the Platte River in Colorado. And the horses and cattle that are driving are getting thirstier and thirstier. And as they reach near the Platte River, as they make it, they start stampeding for the water because it's dry. What they did not know is 100 feet down is a huge 180-foot pool of water. Ice age from the glaciers melting and sinking to the ground. It's still there today. Ogallala Aquifer. And we have tapped into it and created the great wheat and farm fields throughout this region, but it's going down. It's no legislation is there to protect it. And within 40 years, you're going to see farms today have to become ranches. The governor of Colorado has responded by saying, I'll ship you Rocky Mountain water. Hasn't happened yet. So it's crazy. It's crazy. It's been mapped now. You know, you Google things. Now I'm Googling Ogallala. I found kind of a mud contest. Has nothing to do with it, but it's in Ogallala, Nebraska. Which the aquifer is named after Ogallala, Nebraska. All right, so there's still a lot of water where it's blue. That's up here under the great sand dunes in Nebraska. But elsewhere, it's greatly depleted to reds and yellows from its original area. So it's highly depleted. Different maps are saying the same thing. Not much there, all right? So it's going away. And as the water goes away, the land begins to crack. So here's land subsidence sinking away. Areas of subsidence due to groundwater pumping are all over the United States, all over the world, all over my hometown. I grew up right here in Baytown, Texas, outside of Houston. Houston needing a lot of water. NASA needed a lot of water, pumped it out of the ground. And the land where I grew up, half of my hometown is now underwater. It's sunk. It's called Baytown because it's near the bays. All right, so here was a neighborhood that I knew, and that's it today, all right, underwater, sunk into the ground. So this is real, all right, my hometown made the news, all right. Another happens right here in Boston. When you suck too much water, you go drown, you get down to the fresh water, but out in the ocean, the water underneath the ground is salty, of course. So somewhere near the coastline is a boundary of underground water between fresh and salt. If you oversuck this water, you bring the salt water into your wells. That's called saltwater incursion. So there's an issue for anywhere near the ocean, such as in Boston, all right? As early as 1930 in New York City, this was occurring, all right? And you suck at anything, all right? If you're on a farm, and you've got cattle over here, and they go pee-pee and poop-poop and all that stuff. Of course, there's heavy metals and other things gets into the ground, so it's a big issue. Here's somebody with a sewage system, but they put in a bigger well and sucks it right in. So there it goes. And we've talked about acid mine leakage through weathering of sulfide minerals releases sulfur. The water is red because the iron is oxidized. Other things that could get into the ground, oil spills, gas tank leakage, street runoff, MTBEs, and ethanol. We use MTBE as an additive to gasoline. When gasoline spills out on the street, the gasoline evaporates, but the MTBE does not. And it's really bad for you, of course. And so now that's finally getting some good laws. Eutrophication, this is where the groundwater and surface water gets depleted in oxygen. This happens on golf courses. This happens near sewage plants. This happens in the countryside where all the homes have septic tanks. This happens where you have golf courses or homes where you have fertilized too much of your grass and the fertilizers go into the water and cause not grass but algae. Or it's because your sewage is also a fertilizer. Goes into the water and fertilizes. And you get a bloom of algae. The algae consumes all the oxygen and then the fish die. So you get a fish kill. So when I look out and I see water covered with algae, that water is sick. Where'd that come from? Either a golf course or your yard or your sewage. Okay? All right? Unregulated. And so entire communities, because of poisoning of the ground, here we are in Hermann County, Tennessee, had to move. In this case, this was heavy metals that got into the groundwater, not sewage, heavy metals. So they're big issues. I said there's a job for you. It's not just about finding fresh water for the world. It's about protecting the quality of the water we have out there for you and all life forms on this wonderful planet we have. I've got a job. All right? You know the story about Aaron Brokovich. You probably saw the movie. Here's the real Aaron Brokovich. It was a real story. All right? Julia Roberts, oh, she looks good. But they both look good to me. And it was real. Contamination of chromium-6. There it is, chromium-6. Chromium-6 is a cleanser used in laboratories and industry. I've worked with it, not knowing how bad it is. You can really clean chemical glassware. You can clean an industrial engine. People were cleaning the insides of locomotives. Electric plants were cleaning their boxes. And it got into the groundwater table, and no one was talking, and all of a sudden you've got all these birth defects and stillborn babies and miscarriages. What's going on? No one was talking. It was a real lawsuit. A lot of people were damaged. Families. So it's real. So it takes good laws. And like with the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, the first real big one was in 1972. I remember bad water. I remember water skiing in Cedar Bayou outside Baytown, going water skiing and coming out with a rash on the lower half of my body because of the petrochemical plants all along it where I was water skiing by. They put a lot of bad stuff. Buffalo Bayou, another one near Lake Erie, these waters were so foul with gasoline they would catch fire. This is how bad we were turning our water. Boston's harbor was filthy. A cesspool. And we put a dam across the Charles so the water can't get out to the ocean. So it took good laws. We had to do things differently. We had to create sewage plants that regulated how the water was being treated. The Superfund was founded in 1980 to help clean up stuff, and 1986 was another one. And there have been a lot of fallbacks here. The first Bush administration allowed management without tough controls, allowed pollution to occur, and just simply collected taxes. You're polluted, you're going to pay more taxes to a limit. All right? The Clinton administration revitalized the Environmental Protection Agency, but got a lot of criticism, as you can imagine, Republican versus Democrat in industry. The second Bush administration, for the first time in 30 years, negative reversals in air and water quality nationwide a large increase in the number of Superfund sites, places that needed to be cleaned up. In all other administrations, both Republican and Democrat, saw steady improvement since 1972. Until we got to the second Bush administration. The Obama administration has been reviewing all policies, but he wants to get reelected, and this is delicate. You're watching it happen right now, all right? It takes good laws and good people. So let's go underground. Here is a cavern in Guatemala. Oh, look at these crystals. Beautiful crystals of calcite, stalagmites, and stalactites coming out of the ground. This was brand new, discovered in 1986. Hiking around, look at the underground cave, look at the stalactites coming down, the stalagmites coming up, reach it up till they kiss.
Water. We do use water in large quantities. You know, water is essential to life. Without water, there is no life.